Penguin Random House Audio presents Discipline is Destiny, The Power of Self-Control. This is the author, Ryan Holiday. Two words should be taken to heart and obeyed when exerting ourselves for good and restraining ourselves from evil. Words that will ensure a blameless and untroubled life. Persist and resist. Epictetus. The Four Virtues. It was long ago now that Hercules came to the crossroads. At a quiet intersection in the hills of Greece in the shade of knobby pine trees, the great hero of Greek myth first met his destiny. Where exactly it was or when, no one knows. We hear of this moment in the stories of Socrates. We can see it captured in the most beautiful art of the Renaissance. We can feel his budding energy, his strapping muscles, his anguish in the classic Bach cantata. If John Adams had had his way in 1776, Hercules at the crossroads would have been immortalized on the official seal of the newly founded United States. Because there, before the man's undying fame, before the 12 labors, before he changed the world, Hercules faced a crisis, one as life-changing and real as any of us have ever faced. Where was he headed? Where was he trying to go? That's the point of the story. Alone, unknown, unsure, Hercules, like so many, did not know. Where the road diverged lay a beautiful goddess who offered him every temptation he could imagine. Adorned in finery, she promised him a life of ease. She swore he'd never taste want or unhappiness or fear or pain. Follow her, she said, and his every desire would be fulfilled. On the other path stood a sterner goddess in a pure white robe. She made a quieter call. She promised no rewards except those that came as a result of hard work. It would be a long journey, she said. There would be sacrifice. There would be scary moments, but it was a journey fit for a god. It would make him the person his ancestors meant him to be. Was this real? Did it really happen? If it's only legend, does it matter? Yes, because this is a story about us, about our dilemma, about our own crossroads. For Hercules, the choice was between vice and virtue, the easy way and the hard way. The well-trod path and the road less traveled. We all face this choice. Hesitating only for a second, Hercules chose the one that made all the difference. He chose virtue. Virtue can seem old-fashioned, yet virtue, arete, translates into something very simple and very timeless. Excellence, moral, physical, mental. In the ancient world, virtue was comprised of four key components: courage, temperance, justice, wisdom. The touchstones of goodness, the philosopher King Marcus Aurelius called them. To millions, they're known as the cardinal virtues, four near universal ideals adopted by Christianity and most of Western philosophy, but equally valued in Buddhism, Hinduism, and just about every other philosophy you can imagine. They're called cardinal, C.S. Lewis pointed out, not because they came down from church authorities, but because they originate from the Latin cardo, or hinge. It's pivotal stuff. It's the stuff that the door to the good life hangs on. They are also our four topics for this book, for this series. Four books, four virtues, one aim to help you choose. Courage, bravery, fortitude, honor. Sacrifice. Temperance, self-control, moderation, composure, balance. Justice, fairness, service, fellowship, goodness, kindness. Wisdom, knowledge, education, truth, self-reflection, peace. These are the key to a life of honor, of glory, of excellence in every sense. Character traits that John Steinbeck perfectly described as pleasant and desirable to their owner, and makes him perform acts of which he can be proud and with which he can be pleased. But the he must be taken to mean all of humankind. There was no feminine version of the word virtus in Rome. Virtue wasn't male or female, just was. It still is. It doesn't matter if you're a man or a woman. It doesn't matter if you're physically strong or painfully shy, a genius or of average intelligence. Virtue is a universal imperative. The virtues are interrelated and inseparable, yet each is distinct from the others. Doing the right thing almost always takes courage, just as discipline is impossible without the wisdom to know what is worth choosing. What good is courage if not applied to justice? What good is wisdom if it doesn't make us more modest? North, south, east, west, the four virtues are a kind of compass. There's a reason that the four points on a compass are called the cardinal directions. They guide us. They show us where we are and what is true. Aristotle described virtue as a kind of craft, something to pursue just as one pursues the mastery of any profession or skill. We become builders by building, and we become harpists by playing the harp, he writes. Similarly, then, we become just by doing just actions, temperate by doing temperate actions, brave by doing brave actions. Virtue is something we do. It's something we choose. Not once, for Hercules's crossroad was not a singular event. It is a daily challenge, one we face not once but constantly, repeatedly. Will we be selfish or selfless, brave or afraid, strong or weak, wise or stupid? Will we cultivate a good habit or a bad one, courage or cowardice, the bliss of ignorance or the challenge of a new idea? Stay the same or grow, the easy way or the right way. Introduction. Would you have a great empire rule over yourself? Publilius Syrus. We live in times of plenty and freedom that would have been unfathomable to even our most recent ancestors. An ordinary person in a developed nation has at their disposal luxuries and opportunities that all-powerful kings were once impotent to acquire. We are warm in the winter, cool in the summer, stuffed full far more often than hungry. We can go where we want, do what we want, believe what we want. With the snap of our fingers, pleasures and distractions appear. Bored where you are, travel. Hate your job, change it. Crave it, have it. Think it, say it, want it, buy it, dream it, chase it. Nearly anything you want, whenever you want it, however you'd like it, it's yours. This is our human right, as it should be. And yet, what do we have to show for all of this? Certainly not widespread flourishing, empowered, unshackled, blessed beyond expectation. Why are we so damn unhappy? Because we mistake liberty for license. Freedom, as Eisenhower famously said, is actually only the opportunity for self-discipline. Unless we'd rather be adrift, vulnerable, disordered, disconnected, we are responsible for ourselves. Technology, access, success, power, privilege, this is only a blessing when accompanied by the second of the cardinal virtues, self-restraint. From Aristotle to Heraclitus, St. Thomas Aquinas to the Stoics, from the Iliad to the Bible, in Buddhism, in Confucianism, in Islam, the ancients had many words and many symbols for what amounts to a timeless law of the universe. We must keep ourselves in check, or risk ruin, or imbalance, or dysfunction, or dependency. Of course, not everyone's problems are a result of plenty, but everybody benefits from self-discipline and self-control. Life is not fair. Gifts are not handed out evenly. And the reality of this inequity is that those of us coming from a disadvantage have to be even more disciplined to have a chance. They have to work harder. They have less room for error. Even those with fewer freedoms still face countless daily choices about which urges to indulge, what actions they'll take, what they'll accept or demand from themselves. In this sense, we're all in the same boat. The fortunate as well as the unfortunate must figure out how to manage their emotions, abstain from what should be abstained from, choose what standards to observe. We must master ourselves unless we'd prefer to be mastered by someone or something else.
We can say that each.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.